Thank you all for being here. Thank you, Andy and the worship team, for leading us in our songs so wonderfully. Thank you, choir, for presenting the ministry of music to us. And for the rest of us, kids have left. Our pastor is at a wedding this weekend, so it gives us a little break from 1 Peter, and I'm glad to be humbled to be entrusted with the pulpit this morning. I expect today's message to be fairly straightforward to understand. However, I also expect it to be a little bit controversial, and for the theme of the message to be difficult for some people. So here's what I'm asking you to do this morning. I want you to stick with me from now until the end of the message. If something I say confuses you, offends you, I want you to write it down. For some of you, there will be more questions at the end of the sermon than you have at the beginning. And that is to be expected. A few weeks ago, I was reviewing some of the revisions that we want to make to our church's bylaws, and I was looking at some statements about the subject of confrontation and what we call church discipline, and I was comparing them to Scripture. And as I was thinking about it, I said to myself, I would like to preach on this subject. And so I asked Pastor Matt, and he thought it was a great idea. And this week, as the sermon was coming together, I started to chicken out a little bit. And I said, wait, this topic is too deep. It's too difficult. I don't want to do it. Also, this process that we're going to lay out here, I don't think it's something that I'm very good at. So I felt that if I was up here preaching about the subject of confrontation, and I've been at this church for 20 years, perhaps there's been a time in my life where I've confronted one of you in a poor manner. Or that if you have ever confronted me and I have responded poorly, it would be awful, I thought, getting up in front of the dear people of my church family and telling them they need to do something that I'm not very good at myself. And so I'm admitting to you up front that I am not good at this process. I dislike this process. I have failed many times being on the giving end and the receiving end of confrontation. But for the health of our church, for our relationships, this is something that all of us together, all of us, myself included, need to get better at. And so I'm preaching this sermon to you, but I'm asking you, you hold me accountable, and I'll hold you accountable for the content of this message. Once we hear it, unless you fall asleep, once you hear it, you're accountable for it, right? So am I. So here's what I want to accomplish. I want to teach through the passage in Matthew 18, which is about confrontation or discipline when it comes to the church. I want to compare it to 1 Corinthians 5, which we read earlier. I want us to understand the process of confrontation, the roles of everyone involved in it, and most importantly, I want to defend why I think the process here laid out in Scripture is the very best process to preserve the health of the church. So if there's one thing that you take away from this message, it's this, that this process, which almost seems harsh and heavy-handed, I want you to look at it, and I want you to be able to say, wow, this is so good, this is so rich, this is so loving, this is so merciful that God has given us this to equip us for the life of our church. That's what I want to accomplish. So, at the end, you tell me if you think that I accomplished that objective. If you're a person who likes to take notes and likes stuff right in front of you, in the center of your bulletin, I have space for an outline. I have both of the passages that we're going to be using right there printed out. So, I'm going to read the first one. It's Matthew chapter 18. It's verses 15 through 20. It says, if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have gained your brother. But if he does not listen, take one or two others with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly I say to you, Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, there am I among them. And we'll read 1 Corinthians 5 a little bit later, the second, or a little bit towards the end of the sermon. Let me go ahead and say a word of prayer for us, and then we'll get into this text and what it has for us. Our gracious God and Father, I want to thank you for the opportunity that it is to preach the word of God, your word, before your people this morning. I confess the unclarity of my mind and how vast this topic is, that I cannot handle it well. So I ask you to do your will, may your word go forth in the power of your Spirit. Make us, help us as a church to replicate this, to be a church that is able to confront, to do so lovingly for the glory of others, for the glory of God. Father, I pray that that you would give greatness to your word and great prominence to your word among this congregation this morning, that even a year from now, we would be talking about this. Not because I have spoken it, but because it's so clear in the word and impressed upon our hearts by your Spirit. So, Lord, I confess I'm not able to accomplish that, and I ask that you would. I pray this in Christ's name. From these two passages in front of us this morning, largely, along with a couple of others from Acts and the pastoral epistles, we get our theology of confrontation, discipline, and excommunication and other things related. From these two passages, you can extrapolate a clear plan for what you do if you are a local assembly of believers, a church. You have someone in your church who is engaged in a sin that they refuse to give up. What do you do? And I want to point out that there's two things about churches that makes this such a difficult process, but also such an important process. You see, number one, churches are supposed to be places of great love and unity and healing. We want to be a welcoming church. We want people to think of our church as a hospital for sinners. Likewise, churches should also be places of doctrinal purity, of shining righteousness, of personal and corporate holiness. So to put it simply, in a church, you want love, and you want holiness. And how a church balances those two things will affect what the church believes about confrontation and church discipline. Here's what I mean. Let's say you have a church that is really diligent about preserving holiness in their church. They focus on doctrinal purity, personal holiness, personal testimony. If you do something wrong, they're quick to call you on it. They confront you, sometimes too much. They're always negative, always harsh, always authoritarian, always overbearing and reminding you about how you fall so short of what God wants from you. On the other hand, you may have a church that focuses a lot more on love and acceptance and grace. They don't require a lot from you. You can go there, listen to sermons week after week after week, and it's a little bit like self-help. No sermon's ever going to step on your toes in a church like that. They don't care how pure your doctrine is. They don't care how much personal holiness you're pursuing. They never confront or make you feel uncomfortable. In a church like this, you can be living in a pattern of sin that is ruining your life and sinking you downwards, and nobody will bother to confront you because they don't want to make you uncomfortable. And I want to argue today that both those aspects, love and holiness, are essential. They're intertwined. It cannot be one or the other. It has to be both and. And in the process outlined in Matthew 18, verses 15 through 20, there's four stages. And each of them has a various set of responsibilities and a various cast of characters. And I want to go through every stage and look at who is involved and what the unique purpose is of that step and the key people involved in it. By way of context, I want you to remember this is written by Matthew, who was a disciple of Jesus. He was formerly a tax collector. He wrote this about 30 years after the Lord had died and rose again, and we believe he was guided by the Holy Spirit, aided by the other apostles, and he recalled this teaching and included it in the 18th chapter of his gospel, or what we know as the 18th chapter. Back then, when Jesus spoke these words, there was no church. So this teaching may not have made much sense to Matthew when he first heard it during our Lord's ministry. But soon after, well, let me correct that. You know, we believe that the church has always existed, the people of God has always existed, ever since Genesis, but the New Testament expression of the church as we know it was not revealed until Acts chapter 2. So, just by way of clarification. So the church as we know it, Matthew would have been unfamiliar with it, so it might not have made a lot of sense to him, but soon after, the New Testament expression of the church was flourishing, and it probably now made sense to Matthew what Jesus was talking about. So here we are at step number one. This is a step you take when someone, a brother, a fellow believer, I'm going to argue in the context of the church, sins against you. And that's what's required to start this process. Verse 15, if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have gained your brother. So I want to focus on the following clauses this morning. First, I want to talk about the brother. Secondly, I want to talk about what it means that he sins against you. Number three, what does it mean that you have to go and tell? What does it mean that you discuss his fault with him? What does it mean that you do it between you and him alone? What does it mean that he listens and therefore you have gained your brother? Okay, so it says brother. Your brother sins against you. I believe sisters are included here. It's just using masculine noun to include the masculine and the female. Greek writers do that a lot throughout the New Testament. The important thing is that it's talking about believers in the context of a church, because this kind of relationship where you can talk to someone about their sin against you is not something you can do with just anyone. You have to have an agreement on what sin is, why it's important, why it needs to be addressed. I would argue you can only really have that relationship where you can talk about each other's sin with another Christian believer. You obviously cannot do that at your work. You tell someone, "Hey, you sinned against me." They have no idea what you're talking about. This is reserved for the church. Now, that does not mean that there's not principles that you can take out of this passage and apply them to all aspects of your life, whether work or family or school or other relationships. There's principles that we can get out of it, but this is something in its truest form that is reserved for Christian believers. The prerequisite for confronting your fellow believer is that they must have actually sinned against you. Be careful when you confront someone about the wrongdoing. Be careful that it actually exists. Sometimes people in churches, we confront each other about things that are not sin, but just a difference of opinion or preference. Don't confront people for not meeting your expectations. There's nothing wrong with giving people advice or encouragement or constructive criticism. That's good. Scripture encourages us to do that for one another. But if you're going to confront someone for wrongdoing, you need to be sure that it actually happened. That it's not just something that it's perceived in your own mind. It's not that someone did not meet the high expectations that you had for them. It's or something that exists in your perspective alone. I'll give you an example of a difference in preference. I'm not someone who likes going to the movies. I'm not someone who really likes watching movies. In fact, I probably watch a movie at the theater maybe once every 2 years, if that. I just don't enjoy them. I find them incredibly boring. I find the experience of sitting and watching a movie for 2 hours or 3 hours to be very boring. And I'm a very simple person, so when people are discussing the movie, afterwards and they're like, oh, this scene and this happened and this was really cool. And I had no idea how to relate to that. So I always feel a little ridiculous in those discussions. And so that's a preference. But I would be wrong if I was confronting you and saying, oh, you're going to the movies. That is wrong. No, I would never say that. When you confront someone, there needs to be sin involved. Next, go and tell. As much as possible, confrontation requires your presence. Scripture doesn't say inform them or let someone advocate for you on your behalf or find some abstract way to make them know that you are upset. No, it says you go and tell. And this is difficult, especially in the modern technological world that we live in, because we have such an abundance of modern conveniences that it allows us to confront others while removing ourselves, our emotions, our voice, our presence from the situation. Sometimes a phone call is an appropriate way to confront someone. Sometimes an email is appropriate. Sometimes you're not in a position to go meet someone and confront them. But do not let the method that you use overshadow the message that you are conveying. Here's what I mean. Confronting someone by a text message is almost always going to be a failure. I've been burned by this so many times, and it's like, oh man, I wish the Lord helps me to understand this lesson, because it goes horrifically wrong almost every single time. Because it's quick, it's impersonal, it lacks tone. How often, you can tell me if this is true in your life, how often have you sent someone a text message only to find out that they understood it in a way that was completely different from how you intended it? Right? That has happened to every single one of us who has ever sent a text. Sometimes it's all you have, so a text is better than nothing. But I want to encourage you, if at all possible, don't text confrontation. Do it with as much of your presence as possible. Meet with someone. If it's a conversation after church, if it's for over coffee during the week, if it's a phone call, you know, then you're still in not in great territory with a phone call. But as much as possible, you want to try to fulfill where it says go and tell, and you don't do that by texting someone your grievance. Fault. You tell that person your fault. Don't tell them your reaction to their fault. Don't tell them how they made you feel, the heartache that they caused, the broken trust they caused. No, all you're required to do is to tell them their fault. You did such and such a thing. These were your actions. These were your words. This was the attitude that you demonstrated. Don't confront someone if you are just generically offended by them. There must be an actual fault that you are pointing at. I'm offended as a person in the specialty coffee industry. I'm offended by people who drink Starbucks coffee, but who cares? That's not something for which I should confront anyone about. You tell them their fault between you and them alone. And this is how to be loving and gracious to someone who has sinned against you. You show restraint in how you talk to others about it. We're not good at this, folks. Someone who sins against us, we feel victimized and sad. We find someone who is willing to listen. We tell them our story about the hurt and the betrayal and the bad feelings that we have, and they make us feel validated. But once we have gotten it off our chest, then we don't feel like going through with the confrontation because it's not important anymore. Someone heard us out, made us feel validated, and it's over, and then the offense lingers because it's never been cleared up. This is why Scripture says, keep it between you and him alone. Do it privately to preserve and protect the future of that relationship and of the church. How many times has it happened to you that someone sins against you? You tell others, others develop a bad opinion of that person, but later you two are back to having a good relationship, but you have ruined their reputation in the eyes of others. Now, I believe that it's okay to an extent to go to a trusted friend or your pastor and say, hey, pastor, I have this situation in my life where someone has sinned against me. I do not know how to confront him. Either I need your advice or I need you to pray with me to have some courage. That's That's okay as long as you're going to go and do that confrontation. Listen, your brother listens to you. That's the goal. You want them to hear you, to regard what you have to say, to take it seriously, to consider their sin, to seek your forgiveness, to be reconciled to you. So if that is the goal, you must do the confrontation in a way that does not impede that goal. Don't do the confrontation in a poor way. Do the confrontation in such a way that it naturally leads to that goal. And the objective is to gain your brother. It's like sin has created a temporary rift between you and your fellow believer. And the point of confrontation is not to even the score. It's not to make the person feel bad the way they made you feel bad. It's not about rubbing it in. It's not about letting them know how they hurt you or how terrible of a person they are. The point is to gain them so that if you come to them aggressively and selfishly and vindictively, if you emotionally manipulate, if you lay unnecessary guilt upon them, if you keep a historical record of wrongdoings and you're able to rattle it off every time you confront, you will not win them, but you will further alienate them. So do the process in a way where you're aiming to win that person. That's what you do if you've been sinned against. Best case scenario, they hear you, the process ends. Before we escalate it to the next level, I want to give two words of warning. Listen to me carefully. Sometimes you cannot confront someone. It is ill-advised for you to confront someone. In situations where someone has been egregiously victimized by the sin of another person, especially in situations like adultery, sexual abuse, or rape, especially when young people and children are involved, those are not situations that you handle with doing Matthew 18. The reason for this is that things like sexual abuse or rape are different because it's the kind of sin where the person doing the sinful action has so manipulated and coerced and oppressed the personhood and the dignity of the victim that it is appropriate for the victim to step back and let others advocate for the victim. We have means in our society and our churches on behalf of people who are in that situation so that they don't have to confront a person who has intimidated and minimized them and victimized them like you would confront, you know, someone who stole $5 from you. It's not the same thing. Some sins are crimes in addition to being sins and need to be dealt with lawfully, even if the confrontation process is successful to restore the relationship. Sometimes there are extended ramifications in society and in the legal process. For example, you're parked in the driveway, your fellow brother has had a little too much to drink before they come to church, they crash into your car as you're pulling out. Well, that could be a sin of carelessness that you should confront them about, but because of the society that we live in, because of the way the laws are, because of the way insurance works, you would also have to pursue them in another avenue. You might. I'm not saying you should. But just remember the distinction between a sin and a crime, and sometimes both are in play. Stage two, witnesses. You escalate this if your brother does not hear you. So let's say they scoff at you. They say you're crazy. They get aggressive. They end the conversation, they send you a nasty text message later. You have not been heard, the relationship has not been reconciled. At this point, you should escalate it to stage number two. And here, I want to focus on what it says in verse number 16. If he does not listen, take one or two others with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. So I'll focus on the one or two others. Secondly, you take them along with you. Thirdly, so that the charges may be established. Those three things. I'm going to venture to convince you that taking others with you serves at least two important purposes. First of all, in order for you to bring another person into the situation, you have to tell them the situation. And that you have to tell them that the person that you confronted them, they did not listen to you, here was their reaction. So the person you are recruiting to be part of the situation has to evaluate the facts of the situation, and they have to decide if they become a part of it. In essence, they are testing the validity and the integrity of the process. It brings a second set of eyes and a fresh objectivity in the process. Secondly, the extra person also acts as a witness to the reality of the offense. The point is not to strong arm and dominate the sinning brother and make it like two against one. The point is to establish the credibility of the confrontation. I want you to notice that it says take them along with you. If you're going to involve a second person, you need to do it in a purposeful way. At the point where you have reached out to someone to confront them and you have been rejected, the temptation is often that we let it go, or to talk to others about it in order to make the person who sinned against you look bad. But Scripture says that you don't do that. If you're going to tell someone, you do it with the purpose of taking them with you. And so I want to advise you that when someone comes to you and complains about a situation like this, they say, you know, I confronted a fellow believer at the church, they refuse to listen to me, I'm so mad and frustrated. If they say that to you, a good response is, you know what, let's commit it to prayer, and then let's both go and approach them again. The reason being, take the witness so that charges may be established. The purpose of the second confrontation involving this additional person acting as a witness is so charges may be established. Here's what it means. The second person, they come and they affirm the reality of the offense. Therefore, the witness should not just be a random person from your church, but someone at least close enough to the situation where they have witnessed what happened, where they're aware of a pattern of such sin in the life of the person being confronted. Jewish Old Testament law in Deuteronomy 19, verse 5, states, a single witness shall not suffice against a person for any crime or for any wrongdoing in connection with any offense that he has committed. Only on the evidence of two witnesses or of three witnesses shall a charge be established. And that's what our Lord is quoting with when he gives this instruction to his disciples. This in itself is a very beautiful thing because it affords our relationships within the church the same provisions and protections as a legal proceeding would. Third step. If the person rejects even being confronted by two or more people, then you tell the matter to the church. I want to focus only on the word church. Remember, Matthew and the other disciples, when they originally heard it, there was not churches as we know them today. So when Jesus says, tell it to the church, it's the same Greek word for assembly. And that might have been a little confusing for them. They might have thought to themselves, well, what assembly? Our group of 12 disciples? Maybe the synagogue? However, the New Testament expression of the church, as we know it, was revealed in the book of Acts, so the words of Jesus would have then made sense to Matthew and the other disciples. Upon two rejection, the matter is escalated towards the third step. The matter is told to the church, and the church has responsibility then to that individual, because it says if he refuses to listen to the church, which must mean that the church is speaking to him about the situation. The church, maybe the leaders of the church, the pastors of the church are approaching that person, or the church collectively is calling upon that person to repent and to reconcile. And I believe that this implies time. It implies patience. The process is not something that you do in a matter of 3 days. So day one, we confronted them, it didn't go well. Day two, two of us confronted them, it didn't go well. Day three, we brought it up at a business meeting. No, that's not the way it goes. If something comes before the church, how long do you think it should take before the church has done their due diligence to reach out to that believer? Weeks? Maybe months? What kind of patience are we allowed? Are we called to have in this situation? Well, we're not given an exact time period. But I'd say once the church has done its due diligence, and sometimes that is a long process. I want to point out that step three is where you would involve the pastor of the church. In a lot of churches, a falling out happens between two people, and one person goes to the pastor and says, Pastor, you need to deal with this person. Then the pastor tries to half-heartedly approach the other person, not knowing the full story. The person gets offended and they leave the church. And that's not the way it's supposed to be. If you're the offended believer, you're the one who has been victimized by someone's sin, then you need to go to them This is something that we owe to one another if you're part of a church. And one thing that I will say, that just preaching a sermon will not automatically mean that by next week all of us are going to be perfect at this. To be a church like this, it takes time, it takes effort, it takes practice. You know, there's a lot of things that I love about our church. I love our worship team. I love our choir. I love our nursery. I love the way that some of you love and watch out for each other's children. That's a beautiful thing. I love the traditions that we have. I love when we do Christmas. I love when we do International Sunday. I love the flags everywhere, as we'll do in a couple weeks. There's good things about our church that I would never want to give up. I even like our business meetings. I like our youth group. I would not change any of that. I hope to get to 100 years old and we're still doing International Day. Let's never change that. But you know something we should change? Something we need to get a lot better at? We need to get better at talking to each other about important and substantive things. We need to get better at praying with one another, confessing to one another, and challenging one another. We won't all just wake up one day and know the confrontation process perfectly. That's something that we need to develop within the culture of our church, to confess your struggles and weaknesses to one another. If you've never given encouragement to a person in your church or challenged someone with scripture, then you won't be proficient to know how to confront people when there's sin in their lives. So this is something we need to get better at. Let's start talking about that. This is something we need to engage one another, ask one another, hey, how's your prayer? How's your reading in scripture? What is the Lord teaching you in your life? How's your struggles at work? We need to be substantive with one another, or this confrontation process that will be so difficult for us. Step four, if the person refuses the correction of the church, then and only then can you remove them from the church. And I believe what's implied in verse 17, where it says, let them be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. It's removing them, making them an outsider. Gentiles and tax collectors were people regarded as outside of the Jewish faith. The tax collectors were considered to be traitors against the Jewish people. And I think this verse is simply telling us that when you have done your due diligence, you have gone through that process, you've done it with good intentions for the good of that person, you've done it to the glory of God, and you follow the process laid out, and at every turn, the person has dug in their heels, so to speak, refused to acknowledge, refused to hear, refused to repent, then you could regard them as an outsider to the faith. But this is not something you do quickly. This is a long, tedious, laborious, often messy process that requires a lot of prayer and a lot of patience and a lot of time if it's going to be done well. But what's the alternative? What's the alternative to this process? If we don't use what Scripture prescribes, what do we do instead? Well, either we have a church where people sin and you never care enough to approach them and address them. You never care enough to say anything. Or we have a church where at the first infraction, we run to the pastor and say, hey, pastor, this person offended me. You need to kick them out. The person doesn't belong here. What's the alternative if we don't follow Matthew 18? Well, thanks be to God that the church is so important and the believers within the church are so important to the Lord that God gives us this process to preserve and to protect the church. When we rightly practice confrontation as part of the process of making disciples in the church, we can be confident that God Himself is right there with us. It's Jesus who gave us this process. And when we use it, we can be confident that we are doing His will. As it says in verse 18, truly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. How many of you have ever heard that verse? Where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am among them. Right? Sometimes we use that as, okay, well, if two of us are praying together, then the Lord is right there. Well, that's not what it means. It's talking about the context of church discipline. It's talking about confrontation. We often use it wrongly, but in this context, it means that even when a small group of believers are engaging in the very difficult process of confrontation for the good of others, for the purity of the church, for the glory of God, then we can be confident that it's as though Christ himself is right there in the midst. 1 Corinthians 5, we read the story of a man, a professing believer among the Corinthians who was committing incest with his stepmother. And the church was aware of it, and they did not care. A few of the believers who did care about the church wrote to Paul about the situation. Now, Paul has heard from multiple witnesses, and they had likely said, "Paul, help us. We're trying to do the right thing and preserve and protect the purity of the Corinthian church." But nobody cares. We've told our leadership, no, nobody cares what's going on. And Paul writes to them this explosive part in his letter. And Paul says, we're now at the point where, likely confrontation has taken place. They have appealed to this man. The church is aware of it. This is a public thing. And Paul says, we're at the point where you need to dismiss this person from your church. And he doesn't just say terminate them from the Corinthian church. He says deliver this man to Satan, verse 5 of 1 Corinthians 5, so that his spirit may be saved on the day of the Lord. So he's saying, this is not just, don't just resign your membership. He's saying God uses the onslaught of Satan in a believer's life who has persisted in sin to bring about repentance. But be very careful here. 1 Corinthians 5, the sin we're talking about is grievous sexual immorality. It's a sin that's clear, it's public. Everyone knows it's happening. They have already gone through the process, and it has gone so badly, and everyone's turned a blind eye to it, that believers in the Corinthian church have to address the Apostle Paul and say, "Come and help us." This is not 1 Corinthians 5 addressing situations in your church with 1 Corinthians 5. There's a long process before you get to 1 Corinthians chapter 5. And so this is not something that you use in a very careless way. It has to be said that's clear, public. Everyone knows it's happening. You have to have gone through the entire process. It has to be this kind of sin. You don't say, okay, we're going to put someone outside of the church and hand them over to Satan because they're a complainer, because they're a whiner, because they have a bad attitude, they show up to church late. These are not sins you use 1 Corinthians 5 for. Having a different view on a program or ministry of the church. To exempt someone from the body of believers, to tell them they should not partake in the Lord's Supper, to remove them from the blessings and privileges of church membership, that's a very serious matter. I would say it is on par with losing American citizenship. You can lose American citizenship if you're a traitor or a terrorist or something. The church has been around a lot longer than American citizenship. So this is something you deal with very, very carefully, very, very seriously. This is a sacred duty, not something you go about carelessly. We live in a society where we look at the lives of other people and we're often so scared to confront. We pretend it's not our business. Have you ever heard the expression, "It is what it is"? Oh, brother's living in sin. It is what it is. Not my problem. That's the situation. I have nothing to influence it or contribute to it. Well, we live in it is what it is society, but the church is not supposed to be in it is what it is type of community. There's 1,000 more things that could be said about confrontation and the process known as church discipline. I don't believe I've sufficiently even scratched the surface of what could be said, but I think I've laid out the steps of the process and given you a brief overview that we can then build upon. The matter of church discipline and biblical confrontation is so important because Christ did not die to save isolated individuals. Rather, he died to save a people. Our church has the people in it that it does because God has sovereignly arranged it like that. The person sitting next to you this morning in church is a believer. They're here. Their faith is in Christ because Christ has died for them and rose again to purchase them as his own. And that being the case, if that is true, then we all have an obligation to preserve and protect the holiness of the church. You have a responsibility. And I have a responsibility to confront the sin of a fellow believer. You are called to care that much that you put yourself in those uncomfortable situations and conversations with your fellow believers. As we close, there's one actor that we did not address. Remember, we addressed the offended brother, we addressed the witnesses, we addressed the church. You know, there's one more actor. It's the person who's living in sin. As we close, I want to address the final actor, that key player, the sinner, the person who's persisting in sin. What do you do if that's you? If you find yourself on the receiving end of this process, if you are a believer who stubbornly, secretly, resiliently lives in a pattern of sin, and you're just waiting for it to catch up with you. You've positioned your heart and mind in such a way as to justify yourself, and you consider everyone is out to get you and judge you. If that's you, I want to exhort you this morning that your sin will find you out. However, the Lord is near to all who call upon him. Because of Christ the Lord, he will not deal with us according to our sins. There is mercy with the Lord. If you are caught and ensnared in sin, flee to Jesus Christ who died for sin. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, the scripture says. The scripture tells us he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Scripture says, fear not, little flock. It is the good pleasure of your Father to give you the kingdom. Christ died on the cross, 1 Corinthians 15 says, was buried, and he rose again. And his mercy is yours if you will trust in him. So if you find yourself as an unbeliever or a believer ensnared in sin, I would tell you, flee to Christ. There is mercy with the Lord. The word of faith is so near to you. It's in your heart and upon your lips that if you would call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, you will be saved. That is the great confidence that you have wherever you are in that process. Maybe you're a believer living in sin, no one's found out about it. Maybe you've been confronted. Maybe a couple people have confronted you. Maybe the church has confronted you. I don't think that's happening in our church, but you could be from another church. Maybe that's where you are. Repent and trust Christ and turn to the Lord, and he will free you. He will forgive you. Let's pray. Our gracious God and Father, I want to thank you for our Savior Jesus Christ and the full assurance of his pardon and mercy that we have, though we are sinners. Father, may this message not go forth from this pulpit and have the effect that we become good at hiding our sin or ignoring our sin or becoming very legalistic about the sins of others, but that we would truly love and appreciate the gospel of Christ, who has died for sin, who has rose again, who has called out a people for himself. And that people, Father, in so much as we are part of it, I pray that we would be, we'd love people enough that we are willing to have uncomfortable conversations with them, that we're willing to offer confrontation and extend forgiveness for obedience to you, for the good of others, for the glory of God. I pray this in his name.